Matthew and I are going to be filling in, so try not to be too disappointed. But you know, by God's grace, we will do our best here. But the main idea of this is, you know, we're going to talk a little bit about why are you here, and the title for this today is God's Great Desire. And the whole theme of what we're going to be studying throughout the week is it's going to have to deal with what diet and spirituality is, and Dwayne is going to be calling right now, so let me get him on the phone so he can just do a quick introduction for those that are here. So at least we can hear him, and he'll explain to you guys what's going on. Hey, Brother Lemon, I just got up here, and you are on speaker in front of the church body. Go ahead.
Well, hello, everyone. I am so sorry that I couldn't be there with you this evening. I was truly looking forward to it. But it seems as if, as I just heard, there are storms all around the country. And unfortunately, right out here in Texas, there are storms that have caused many, many delays as well as cancellations. This is something that's quite a bit beyond our control, but nevertheless, we know God is still in control. And so as sorry as I am that I was not there with you this evening, I'm trusting by God's grace that as of tomorrow evening and onward, not only will we make up for tonight's presentation, I'd like to still take tonight's presentation and start it tomorrow, but we'll see how the Lord leads with that. But no matter what, we will go ahead and continue with the entire week. We'll make sure that we still get to merge everything in. And I know that when I see the hand of the enemy fighting this hard against God's work going forward, it simply means that there's a great blessing getting ready to come. So let's look forward to a powerful blessing, and I solicit your prayers on behalf of my family and I that will make it all the way in safely, and then by God's grace we'll be seeing you all beginning tomorrow evening.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Lemon. I will have a good flight and keep us posted. God bless you too. So thank you for that. So the whole idea behind it is what we eat goes into our bellies, and from our bellies it goes into where? The bloodline, right? And from the bloodline it goes to your brain. Your brain does what? It thinks, decides, help you make decisions, that turns into actions. Your actions become habits, and habits form your character, and your character takes you to your destiny, right? So that's the whole series of what we're going to be emphasizing on. So let me do that again, everybody. What we eat goes into our stomachs. From the stomachs, that gets processed into your bloodline. From the bloodline, it goes to your brain. Your brain forms your decisions, your thoughts, and then those thoughts turns into decisions, your words, and then they form actions, and then from the actions make habits. Habits form your character, and character forms your destiny. So what is the only thing that we're going to take with us? It's our characters. So is eating something and diet, is that important to our health and spirituality? Absolutely. Okay? So with that, I'm going to pass it on to Matthew, and then we'll be kind of going back and forth.
Before we begin, just keep in mind that we didn't prepare to speak today. We are literally speaking off the Lord's mercy. Amen. So this will be successful only if God's people pray for us as well. So make sure you pray for us as we speak. We are not going to go through the whole thing. I don't think we will do justice since we haven't prepared for these slides, but we are going to work with what we got. And now it's working. So before we begin, let's do a quick word of prayer, and then we're going to go to the Gospel of Luke. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, King of Kings, Father, just because Dwayne's not here, Father, does not mean that you're not here. And Father in heaven, if the King of the universe is present, then there will be a blessing. So Father, I ask that you bless both of us up here to speak for you. And Father, just let Jesus be brought out. And let everyone in this place, Father, leave with an encouragement, knowing that they serve a God who isn't just a creator and not just a savior, but a healer. So thank you, Father, for your love. And thank you, Father, because we know you're going to be here. Send your Holy Spirit to speak to us and to fill everyone here and to teach us all. In Jesus' name, amen. So with that being said, can we turn to Luke chapter 13. Luke chapter 13. When you're there, say amen. Luke chapter 13, when you're there, say amen. Luke chapter 13, that's in the New Testament. It's in the Gospels. When you're there, say amen. And we will be in verse 10. Awesome. That's like five of us. When we're there, say amen. Awesome. Good stuff. I bring us here because we're going to learn a powerful point from this, and I hope this point, it speaks to your heart. So it starts in verse 10. Now he was in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and behold, there was a woman who had a spirit of 18 years, and was bent over and could in no way raise herself up. Verse 12. But when Jesus saw her, so who saw her? Jesus. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said to her, "Woman, you are loose from your infirmity." And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. But the ruler of the synagogue answered with because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath. And he said to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which men ought to work. Therefore, come and be healed on them, and not on the Sabbath day." The Lord answered him and said, "Hypocrite, does not each one of you on the Sabbath loose his ox or donkey from the stall and lead it away to to water it?" Now watch this. This is the point. "So ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound, think of it, for 18 years be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath?" And when he had said these things, all his adversaries were put to shame. And all the multitudes rejoiced for all the glorious things that were done by him. I bring this up because there's a common misconception in the world today, and it's not even just among people outside the church, but even within the church. There's a conception thinking that God is a God who inflicts pain. God is a God who inflicts disease. God is a God who, when that person is on their deathbed and they're dying of cancer, they say, "Well, it must have been God's will for them to have this disease." And I know that because I have a friend who died of cancer. And God forbid, I hope no one ever said it must have been God's will for him to have that disease. There is this whole conception in the world today that teaches God is the one that bounds people in disease. And for all we know, someone in this room today might have that same conception. "Lord, I am struggling with this disease. Is it you?" And I want to tell you today, Jesus is not the author of disease. Jesus is not the author of pain. The Bible teaches Jesus doesn't bound you in chains, but he sets you free. And Jesus here, he wants to make it very clear. He tells the people in charge, which were the Pharisees and also the people, "I did not bound this woman in chains. I did not bound her in a physical sickness. On the contrary, I'm the one who sees her in her sickness, and I'm the one who tells her, I'm going to set you free." So I mentioned this because we have the question on the screen, why are you here? It would not be a surprise that there are individuals today in this room sitting in these pews that are struggling with some form of disease, some form of sickness, some form of bad health. And I just want you to know right from the get-go, and more importantly, it's not me and Andrew, but Jesus wants to let you know right from the get-go, Jesus did not give you those diseases.
Amen.
Jesus is the one who has called you. If you're here today, it's because the Holy Spirit has led you, and Jesus is saying, I have a blessing in store for you, and I am about to show you how I'm going to set you free. So, you want to mention anything, Andrew?
Yes, and you know, Elder Lemon, when he first came to Edinburgh Church, when we brought him down, there are several of you that were here, and he was a humongous blessing. Now, I had been raised, you know, Adventist, and my family's vegetarian, and all these other things, but it didn't become reality to me until I saw a living faith. Does anybody know what a living faith is? It's when you see somebody living their faith, right? They're not just speaking about it, they're living it. So I specifically wanted to have him stay with us in our house because I wanted to see how that family interacted. Now, I know, you know, I could have gotten them in a hotel room or whatever the case, but, you know, my family, we, being the family life directors at Edinburgh SDA, we wanted to see how this family, if it was truly the same as they were on screen and YouTube, as they were in their real lives. And I can attest to you, you know, one of the things that, talking with Dwayne Lemon was, he said, the greatest compliment that I ever got was from my wife. And I said, what are you talking about? And he told me, he said, she had the opportunity to introduce me one time. And he said, I don't cry very much, but he said he broke down in tears. I don't know if you remember that story. Do you remember that story? Mm-hmm. No? He broke down in tears, and he says, as she came up to introduce him, she told him, the man that I'm about to introduce you to on this pulpit is the very same as he is up here, as he is at the dinner table, as he is in the car, as he is when he's in a public place, and everything else. So it was a living testimony, living faith. And it's important to us when we go out there, as we're preaching the health message, we also should be living it. Amen? Okay. So with that slide of why are you here, when I was with them, their living testimony gave me encouragement to become, you know, health conscious in our family. Now, ultimately, I'm not trying to put him on a pedestal because, you know, who was the one and the author of his faith? Jesus. It was Jesus. Jesus came into his life and gave him that living testimony for us. MSN June, did you want to go through this one?
Or? Oh, you can go through.
Okay. MSN June 6, 2014, the latest look at the United States healthcare system compared to other rich countries shows yet again that the United States come in dead last. We are supposed to be the medical mecca, but we're not. We actually came in dead last out of the 11 countries. Americans spend far more per person on medical care, yet are less healthy than people in 10 other countries. The system is less fair than the systems in other rich countries, and is far less efficient, ranking last of 11 nations, the Commonwealth Fund report reads. Forbes, February 2, 2014, annual U.S. healthcare spending hits $3.8 trillion. Do you know how much money that is, guys? Do you know? I mean, that's more than several hundreds of countries' entire yearly budgets. So just to give you an example, that's how much money that we are spending on healthcare. So God's great desire, what we're going to be talking a little bit about, is a biblical emphasis on health. How did we get into this mess to begin with? If you remember back into the Garden of Eden, what did it start out with? An appetite, right? She ate something she wasn't supposed to. How many guys eat something you're not supposed to? Yeah, some of us may, you know, some we may say meats and we may see all this other stuff, but even sugar, do you know sugar is actually classified as a poison? It has no health benefits to us. But we forget that one. You know, we forget the sugar aspect. We talk about like the meats and the blood and the fats and all this other stuff, and the unclean meats. That's all true too. But sugar is just as bad. How many of us have a sugar addiction? I'm gonna tell you a quick story really quick, and the only reason why we're up here is this story was told to me. You guys know of a guy named Gandhi, right? Well, this is a true story. There was a mother who had a son who had a sugar problem and a sugar addiction. And what happened was she didn't know what to do with him, so she asked him to take, she took her son to Gandhi and said, Gandhi, can you please tell her to stop eating sugar? And he said, okay, well, bring her back in 2 weeks. And she's like, what? What are you talking about? Why 2 weeks? So just bring her back in 2 weeks. So she does, and she couldn't understand, but in 2 weeks later, time goes by, she brings back her son to Gandhi, and Gandhi just looks at him and says, okay, stop eating sugar. And she's like, why did it take you that long to tell my son to quit eating sugar? And she says, because I had to stop eating sugar first. Sometimes we tell people these things and we don't live our faith. So we need to understand what we're doing and why we're doing it, because the ultimate goal is because that's the best plan. Amen? The reason why we keep God's law is because John 14, 15 says, if you love me, the love has to be the reason. God has the best choice and the best health plan for us. We don't have to rely on our insurance companies and what coverages and all these other things. He has the best plan for us. All we have to do is listen. Go ahead.
So now God obviously, he has a desire for us to understand that God's not the inflictor of disease, but he's the one who sets us free and heals us. But the thing is that God isn't just a God who says, hey guys, I don't give you disease, but I set you free. He also wants us to know that that his word speaks of this too. Let's look here. Third John, verse 2. If you have your Bible, you could go there. If not, it's on the screen. It says, beloved, I wish what? Above all things, which means what? Above all things. That is paramount. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as what? Thy soul prospereth. The Bible teaches that when you come to God, are you going to prosper as a person? Yes. Are you going to grow spiritually? The closer you come to Jesus, are you going to grow spiritually? But the Bible tells you that that's not enough. God doesn't just want you to grow in a spiritual aspect, but he's telling you, through John, he wants you to grow in health even as thy soul prospers. Jesus wants you to grow in all aspects of life. And the interesting thing here in the bottom, it reads, the term even as means just as. So if you're growing spiritually, but in other aspects you're not, just know today that it is God's desire for us to grow in all aspects of life. And the beautiful thing is God will not tell us that if he wasn't able to do it. So let's look at this next slide. Oh yeah, we're not using slides, we're using PDFs. That's why it's flying real quick. So this is the ideal. How much does God want us to prosper spiritually? In Matthew 5 verse 48, it actually says that God wants us to be perfect just as our Father is in heaven. So that's pretty strong language. And Jesus, who I must remind you is who? God is saying, I want you to be perfect just as your Father is in heaven. Then in Jude verse 24, he says, I want you to be faultless, perfect. These are all type of words Jesus is using, or the Holy Spirit is inspiring the people to understand. I want you to be perfect, faultless. But here's the thing. Just because that's the ideal and just because that's the standard God wants us to aim at, is that reality? I'm asking the question. Is that reality? Is the world at the point where we are faultless in our health? No. And the interesting thing is the Bible actually shows that. Let's go here together. The book of Matthew, chapter 24, verse 4 and 8. 4 through 8. When you're there, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Do you want to read it, Andrew?
Sure. Matthew 24, verses 4 through 8 says, I'm reading from the King James Version. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nations shall rise against nations, and kingdoms against kingdoms, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. All things are the beginning of sorrows.
Who here has seen the news lately for the past few days? A few of you. Who here has a TV? Maybe that's a proper question. because only a few hands went up. If you haven't noticed, some pretty crazy things are taking place around the world. And if you just get on Facebook or if you get on any form of social media, it's as if even the secular world acknowledges we are on the edge of World War III. It's just, there's a feeling in the air. I have a friend who's a... He used to be, because he just told me that he doesn't do this no more, but he used to be a practicing shaman. I don't know if you all know what that is. I don't have time to get into it. That's for another topic. This guy who, he doesn't study the Bible, he doesn't know prophecy. The one thing that we both agree on is the world is in an interesting place, and it seems like if the world is about to come to an end. And the crazy thing is sometimes we just focus on the wars. Sometimes we just focus on the chaos. But Jesus, when Jesus is looking toward the future, he sees the wars, but he also sees pestilences, which is talking about health. Jesus says, don't just focus on the wars. The wars are a sign. But when you see the people and their health reflects the condition of the earth, then you know that I'm coming soon.
So in any type of disease or anything that's going, and there's a lot of medical professionals here, I can see, what's the first thing that you have to do? You have to ascertain the...
cause.
What caused it, right? Did you know that the number one killer in the world in any country that you go to, guess what it is? Can anybody guess? Heart disease. Any country that you go to, the number one killer in the world is heart disease. Now, what causes you to get heart disease? Cholesterol, stress, all kinds of things like that. So it's no wonder. You know what the number two cause is here in the United States? It's colon cancer. I know specifically to that because my wife just recently went through that. And I found out the causes of colon cancer is from eating red meat. The number one cause of colon cancer is eating red meat. Anyways, just a little thing that I wanted to throw in there. But let's find out what the cause is. And Matthew, if you want to read Proverbs 26, verse 2. I'd like to get more interactive with you, if you don't mind. I know we got a little bit of time left, but can somebody walk around with this mic and read some verses? Because I believe there's power in God's word. Amen? If we just read it... I believe.
So are we all there? Proverbs 26, verse 2. When you're there, say amen. If you need time, say have mercy.
And whoever wants to read it.
Just with a show of hands, whoever wants to read it. And
raise your hands if you'd like to go ahead and read. Go ahead, over here, Robert.
Proverbs 26, verse 2.
Like a fluttering sparrow or a darting swallow, an undeserved curse does not come to rest.
So the Bible's teaching already, God doesn't want you to think just because something happens to you, it just happened for no reason. If there is a cause, there was an origin behind it. If something happened to you, it's a cause and effect, which we're actually going to get into later. But the Bible's teaching you right from the get-go, and we're trying to find out what's the causes of diseases. The Bible's teaching that, to quote again, so a curse without cause shall not be aright. So if there is diseases, if there's sickness, we have to understand that, is there a cause to that? It doesn't just happen. It doesn't just fall upon you. Let's go to Numbers chapter 12. It's the same thing. Okay. When you're there, say amen. For the sake of time, I don't think we have to go through each verse, but we could get to verse 9, 10, and 11. When you're there, say amen. The context basically is, you'll see. It's, the meat is in verse 9, 10, and 11.
Who wants to read? Would somebody like to read that out loud? Go ahead, Irene.
And the anger of the Lord was kindled against them, and he departed. And the cloud departed from off the tabernacle, and behold, Miriam became leprous, white as snow. And Aaron looked upon Miriam and said, behold, she was leprous. And Aaron said unto Moses, alas, my lord, I beseech thee, lay not the sin upon us wherein we have done foolishly and wherein we have sinned.
So just keep this in mind. What took place to the woman, what's her name? Miriam. What took place? She got what? Okay. And then in the next verse, what did they say was the cause of it? Don't let this sin fall upon us. The Bible is letting you know that with disease, there is a connection to what? Sin. So then the next question should be, well, what is sin? And 1 John 3:4, we don't have to go there, just basically say sin is lawlessness. So sin is what? Lawlessness. Now the question is, well, if it's lawlessness, or the way the Bible says in another place, it's the transgression of the law, the most logical thing to say next is, well, which law? Because I don't know if you all know this, but the Bible presents a lot of laws. So which law? And if you go to Romans 7:7, let's go there. This is a good verse. You're going to find out which law. When you're there, say hallelujah. Can someone read it out loud with a show of hands?
Mr. Wooden, can you read it for us? Romans 7:7.
What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law. For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet.
So according to the Bible, which law talks about thou shalt not covet? The Ten Commandments. So let's just follow this. The Bible teaches that disease and an affliction in that realm applies to sinning. What is sin? The transgression of the law. What law? The Ten Commandments. Are we all together? That's the progression. So that's the thing that's not popular. It's not preached a lot, but according to the scripture, it's not according to Andrew, it's not according to me, but according to the scripture, there is a direct connection from the way our body interacts with this world and how we interact with God's law. There is a direct connection. And that might not seem real, but I'll believe God's word any day over anyone else.
So what is biblical sickness? Isaiah 1, verse 4 and 5 says, ah, sinful nation, as we just read, a people laden with iniquity and a seed of evildoers, children that deal corruptly, they have forsaken Jehovah. They have despised the Holy One of Israel. They are estranged and gone backwards. Why will ye be still stricken that ye revolt more and more? The whole head is sick and the whole heart faint.
So according to this, pertaining to sickness, is it something that just affects one part of you, or is it the whole body? The whole body. So biblical sickness is a holistic approach to life. But let's read about health. According to the Bible,
Psalm 67:1-2 says, God be merciful unto us and bless us and cause his face to shine upon us, Selah, that thy way may be known upon the earth, thy saving health among all nations.
So according to the Bible as well, sickness is a holistic thing. It affects our whole bodies. But the Bible teaches us that health is according to the way of the Lord, and it's saving health. Now, the question would be, what is God's way? If you all don't know, a side note, we have a program on Saturdays in the evening called The Way. I encourage you all to come. But back to this, what is God's way? The next slide shows us.
All of them? Yeah. John 5:14 says, afterward Jesus findeth him in the temple, and said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon thee. Matthew 9:22, but Jesus turned him about, and when he saw her, he said, daughter, be of good comfort, thy faith hath made thee. And the woman was made from that hour. Acts 4:10. Be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. And the very God of peace sanctify you. God wants to heal us, not partially, wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
See, brothers and sisters, there's a lot of times when preachers preach, they only preach about Jesus just wants to save you from sin and death. And is that true? It's yes, it is true. But according to the Bible, he wants to save you what? It's with the W. Holy. He wants to save you in all aspects of life. What is it? I have a friend who once told me, he said, I don't want to hear about your Jesus because your Jesus cannot help me with the real problems I'm experiencing right now. And at the time, I was a new Christian. I didn't know what to say. And I remember I told him, well, do you want to study prophecy? And he said, you're not hearing me. He said, I have problems I'm experiencing right now that I need help with. And if your Jesus can't help me with those, then I don't want to hear about him. He said, I don't have time to hear that. And at the time, I didn't know what to say. But if you think about it, that's the truth. If we would present to the world that there is a Savior who doesn't just want to save you from sin and death, and he doesn't just want to save you from the sin-sick world, but he even wants to save you from the wickedness of this world right now while you're living in it. He wants to give you life and life more abundantly. If you present to them that type of Savior, which is the biblical Savior, you would be surprised how many people want this Savior, because everyone wants him.
I want to add to that also, you know, and I love that, because God doesn't want to just, like you said, doesn't want to just save us from our sins. He wants to restore his image in us. There's so many things that we are tempted with every single day. And more than anything else, I mean, coming from a background of addictions myself, some of you know my stories here. It was very, very difficult to do that. And I can tell you, by God's grace, he can restore all problems that we've had back to his own image if we will allow him to do that.
What causes a drunken man who has been a drunken man for years to tell me to my face a week ago, it is because of him I have no more chains to this wickedness? That's what he told me. A drunken man who, he lost his wife, he lost his kids, and he tells me boldly, and praise God, I hope one day he's going to come, because he told me he is, and maybe you guys could all see him. He told me he has been bound to alcohol for years, but there is a man named Jesus who has set him free. And that's the message that should be preached more and more.
Amen. So what's the solution, Matthew? Jeremiah 33 verse 6, somebody read it out loud.
Who would like to read it with Shohan? And we're almost done, don't worry.
Jeremiah 33:6. Behold, I will bring it halt and cure, and I will cure them, and will reveal unto them the abundance of peace and truth.
So is God interested in health? Is God interested in cure? All right, can someone else read the next verse? Exodus 15.
If thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and wilt do that which is right in his sight, and wilt give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians.
So the Bible is very clear that if the people would heed God's commandments, they wouldn't be striked with what? Diseases. And that's something that we don't have time to go into tonight. But the Bible is teaching that there is a God who's not just a Savior, but he's a healer as well. And this is our second to our last slide, so don't worry. You'll be out by 8.
And that probably won't happen with Dwayne.
It won't happen with Dwayne. it won't happen with Dwayne, so be prepared. Yeah. So the Bible reads, bless the Lord, O my what? and forget not all his what? Who forgiveth all thine iniquities and what? All thy diseases. So does God want to heal your diseases? Does God want to forgive you? It's no coincidence that in the same verse you read that God wants to forgive, but he also wants to heal. He's not just a forgiver, he's a healer. And we need to keep that in mind, because that's the gospel the world is longing to hear. A savior who wants to save them, not just from the penalty of sin, but from the experience of sin that they experience every single day. So with that being said, I pray that Jesus, the man upon that cross, spoke to your hearts today. We are not Dwayne, but we had a few moments in the back to prepare. And we just want to encourage you all that if you continue to come and you have an open heart, I promise you that the God of the Bible, the God that you just read about, the God who is not just a savior but a healer, will provide healing in your life. And if you don't believe that, you're standing in front of someone who has experienced healing, and you're seeing someone who has experienced healing. If I would tell you my testimony about how I was in college, you wouldn't believe me. And praise God that that Matthew is dead and gone. And now I am crucified with Christ, and a new one stands before you today. Amen. So Jesus is not just a savior, but he's a healer. And that healer wants you to continue coming, because he has a blessing for you.
Amen. And just to finish off too, you know, as a personal testimony to let you guys know, since we made a family decision, many of you guys know me. Robert knows me specifically. I used to weigh 260 pounds. So just to give you an example, and you know, through diet and health, you know, God gave me a chance to slim that down, you know. And God can do miracles in anybody's life. It's that I'm nobody special. You know, my favorite foods, I won't mention them, but you know, but let me tell you something specifically, friends. Brandon works at our office, and he took a challenge from me. And I think you're still on it, right? Okay, good. I challenged him to a 180-day vegan diet. And I said, just give it 180 days and let's see what happens. How many of you guys seen that movie, Forks Over Knives? Have you seen it? If you haven't seen it, I challenge you to watch it. It will be life-changing. Because these aren't even Christians that are saying these things. Christians aren't the ones that are talking about this. These are doctors and medical scientists that are doing this and telling us that, you know, dairy, you know, meat and all this other stuff is killing us. But when we look at the cross and we see the God of the universe give up everything for us to have a second chance at life, how much more the more responsible we should be in following God's word. And that's what this whole series is going to be about. What does God have to say about my lifestyle, the one that he wants me to have, and how it can be changed? Because if you think you can't live without chicken strips or church's chicken, you can. Because let me tell you something right now, my taste buds have changed. I've only been doing this since February of last year, guys, just to give you an example. But your taste buds change, and now the things that I used to desire, I don't even desire it. It's not even, don't get me wrong, in the beginning it was hard, especially when people were like, you know, eating that, I mean, that cheeseburger and everything else. Those things I craved, but now I could be in front of it and it just grosses me out. Like, I don't even want it. And praise God for that. God can do that change in yours and let you be a living testimony as to what God can do in your life to change and to bring others closer to him. Amen? Anything else that you wanted to add?
Yeah, I just want to close with one verse real quick. In Romans chapter 5, verse 20, you don't have to go there, but has anyone here ever tasted the power of sin? Has anyone ever experienced the power of temptation? Yes, everyone's hand should be going up, right? I didn't ask for it, but your hand should have. Here's the thing. The beautiful thing in this verse, it says, where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. So if you have felt the power of temptation and sin, be prepared to see the power of grace. Amen. Which is so much more powerful. With that, we'll be closing with a word of prayer. And feel free to talk to the substitutes or anyone else.
Yeah, before we go, do you guys have any questions or anything that you guys want to field? Any questions or personal testimonies that you'd like to share?
Not everyone at once. Okay, that's fine.
And like I said, you know, I didn't mention this part, but I was a humongous coffee drinker. And if you don't know that, I honestly did not know how I was going to live without it. Before even the seminar started, it was 6 cups, 7 cups a day of black coffee, and then the 5-hour energies, and then I'd go work out, and thinking, now I run half marathons with none of that. And it's just, you know, God can do miracles in your life, and I'm telling you, we think that the substitute stuff that we're drinking is what's giving the energy, but the only thing that's going to really, truly give us the energy is the power of the Holy Spirit and Jesus living through us. So does anybody else have any, nobody has any testimonies? Brandon, do you want to say something about you? How long have you been doing this already? February? I'm going to challenge some people too. And see, just to see what's going to happen in your lives. So go ahead, tell us a little bit about your testimony, Brandon.
So when I started this, I was just eating, before I used to weigh 225 pounds, my senior year in high school. And as some of my friends here remember me, I was a lot bigger. And before I started this, I was pretty miserable. I didn't have good joints growing up, and I felt the pain all the time. So I decided to make a change even before going vegan. And I just started cutting back on how many times I ate a day. I used to eat 4-5 times a day, just snacking in between. And now I eat once to twice a day. And I don't feel as bad as I used to. Before, I used to dread eating at least twice a day. I get so hungry. But I ended up shrinking my stomach. Because when I would eat, I'd always eat till I was full and not satisfied. So I made it a challenge to eat until I was satisfied and not full anymore. And slowly but surely, my portions started cutting down. Instead of eating 2 plates every meal, I could barely finish a plate. And if I do eat a whole plate of a meal, it's just once a day. So I'm satisfied. Today I ate once, and that's it for me. even then, like going on, when I started going vegan, I felt more energized. My sleeping patterns changed as well. Even though I do wake up a little late, I don't wake up as tired anymore. I wake up with more energy and, get more things done. So, I know going more plant-based, more raw food diet has been a great help, and it's easier when you have people who help you. My grandparents, they have been a great help to me, especially my grandmother, because majority of the food that we eat is from our garden, her garden, I should say. And I would recommend you guys start a personal garden. It doesn't have to be something big or fancy, just typical greens and this and that, and it's a real blessing. Right now, I currently weigh less than 180 pounds, and 190, so around 180. And I hadn't weighed this much since maybe my sophomore year in high school. So it's different. I'm able to be a little bit more confident in myself. And it just feels better. It really does. If there's anything, that's all I can really say.
All right, thank you, Brandon. That's it.
Yeah, so with that, we'll be closing with a word of prayer. I just want to say that this isn't, if you attend, you're not going to be forced to become a vegetarian or have a plant-based diet, but all that's trying to be communicated is God could bless you in many, many ways. And the more you give him, the more that you're able to receive. And it's a beautiful thing, and we ask that as you guys continue coming, you all will learn a bunch of awesome things, and it'll affect your life. So with that being said, we'll have a closing word of prayer. And what time are you all going to be here tomorrow? 6:45, great answer. Because it starts at 7. It starts at 7, so get here a little bit before. Alrighty, so with that being said, let's have a word of prayer, okay? Our Heavenly Father, King of Kings, we are so thankful, Father, that you are a God who could speak through people on the fly. Andrew and I, Father, had no time to prepare, and we are just glad that you actually made this pretty easy for us. And we thank you, Father, for the people here. I ask, Father, that as they continue to come, that they don't see a health message per se, but they see Jesus. And because of seeing Jesus, they are willing to do anything this man says, because this man was willing to do anything for them. And Father in heaven, Lord, I pray that you continue just to win us over to you, bring our hearts back to you, and turn these stony hearts into hearts of flesh. And let us know the man who was once upon a cross and who is now pleading before us in heaven right now. We thank you, Father, for your love. We thank you for your faithfulness. And we thank you for the future blessings you're going to give us by attending these daily seminars. So thank you, Father, for your love. And we can't wait to be with you again tomorrow at this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.